Be blessed this morning. I don't want to take up any time from these sweet ladies, and we'll have another one. Amanda will be coming here shortly, I'm sure. But Betsy and Kathy and Amanda were in Israel with the group from church a week or so ago, right? And they wanted to come back. Betsy started saying something about it before she even got back. Could we share when we come back? I'm like, yes, please, please do. So we are so thankful that they are coming this morning to testify to what they've seen and heard and touched so that we can be blessed by it. So go ahead and start off, Betsy. All
right. So where's the on button?
Click it up.
Click it up?
Yep.
It might be.
Oh.
Push it up.
Hello.
There you go. You're on.
Okay. Oh, there's Amanda. All right. All right. Well, welcome, everybody. Thank you for letting us share. First, I want to say welcome to Israel. This is basically what I looked like the entire time because we had weather just like this all but two days that we were there. And it's funny because through the meetings that we had prior to the trip, Fred, our leader, kept saying, pack a carry-on, pack, you know, something you can put in the overhead, don't go with the big bags. And okay, who of you could go for 10 days halfway across the world with a group of people you don't know and pack something to put in the overhead? I honestly tried. Well, as it turns out, yeah, as we got into this weather that we had over there, it was crazy because this is every picture that I have. This was my uniform, so... So it was part of the experience too. It was just so amazing. So hopefully we'll do it justice. I did want to share a little bit about kind of where we were. Let me see if I can operate, if I have the technical ability here. So, oh, another one. Okay. So we, when we started out, we flew up to San Francisco on a Friday afternoon and headed from there over to Tel Aviv. So a nice 17-hour flight. That was quite the experience in and of itself, but we made it. So let me see. But Tel Aviv, okay, the pointer's not pointing. Is that not? Oh, there we go. Where am I? Okay, I'm not. Okay, so Tel Aviv is right. I can't really see the map here, but oh, there it is. Okay, so we flew in right here, spent the night here, and then we went up. Nazareth is up this direction. So we were able to spend 3 nights in Nazareth. And from there we went, this is the Sea of Galilee. This is the top of Israel right here, the Golan Heights you've probably heard of. I mean, Syria is right there. And Turkey, where the earthquake, you know, that's all southern, you know, Turkey is north of, it's not quite on the map, but there. So, you know, we were in the region, but never ever had any fear, whether it was, you know, with the unrest that was happening or with the earthquake in Syria and Turkey. I mean, it was just, God protected us. And I know the ladies will talk a little bit more about that as well. But then we went from Sea of Galilee, you know, Mount of Beatitudes is at the north end of the sea. Jordan River is more down south of here. So we were making our treks up here from Nazareth and then down to Jerusalem. So the Dead Sea is here. And some of the things we experienced were the Dead Sea. Masada is down here at the south end of the Dead Sea. We'll talk about that a little bit, with Jerusalem being right up here. So that was always our home base for the last part of our trip. And then back to Tel Aviv and home. So I just wanted you to kind of have a feel for where we were. So I'm gonna turn it over, whoops. Is that you?
That's me.
We've got, we're out of order. Oh, I went backwards, sorry about that. Did I go the wrong way? No. Okay, well, we're going to have to reverse order. You know what? And I don't know that if yours are in order or not, but we'll let you do your own.
My pictures are not in order.
Okay.
Apparently we found out.
So we're going to go, or should
okay.
we go to the back of the...
You could just flip through to get to...
You have other photos?
Well, we
flip
have other
photos,
but...
just go to wherever you want.
Yeah, just click
those
through.
Those are mine, and Kathy is going to go first, so let me do this and we'll go backwards.
Okay.
There we go.
All right.
Go back to the.
Go back.
Go back.
I think we had a good order going.
or we wanted to go in the order of kind of what our trip was. So hopefully that makes some logical sense.
Well, good morning. Can you hear me? Okay, there we go. This is going to be interesting because I'm going to be reading as well as holding this and turning pages, so bear with me. My name's Kathy Till, and I've been coming to Illuminate for quite a while, but I was one of those people that Pastor Jason talked about who would come on Sunday, sit in the back, and then as soon as service was over, I would leave. And I would, during COVID, watch everything online. And so when it came time to do the Israel trip, it was like I had reached a milestone in my career. And I had retired from Lazy Boy Furniture Galleries after 25 years. And I knew it was time for me to take on and explore a new journey. And so I felt like Illuminate would be my next journey. And so when the trip came up, it's like I just was compelled and had to go. And again, not knowing anybody at all and trying to remember everybody's name was a lot of fun, but I got it. So when we got back and we were talking about what it is we wanted to talk about this morning, she said, you know, what are your new perspectives? What was it that God shared with you and showed you? And so I'm going to kind of read what I wrote. And here we go. Before retiring and after the trip, I was really confused and overwhelmed. And it was crazy because there was so much unrest. My family was like, why are you doing this? There's all this going on. But during the course of the whole time, I was always at peace. I felt like it was my journey. I felt like this was, again, the beginning of my journey and something that I needed to do. And so I always felt safe and felt secure. Towards the beginning of the trip, we made our way to the Sea of Galilee. This is a picture of it. And as we got closer to the Sea of Galilee, I couldn't believe how beautiful and how peaceful. And as we walked around, I remembered that it was at the Sea of Galilee where Jesus met Simon, who became Peter, and his brother Andrew at the Sea of Galilee and said, come follow me. And so they began a new journey. So I'm like, okay, this is kind of cool. I can see where this is going, right? You know, so consequently, because they decided it was time for a new journey, so did I. And can we go to the next one? Okay. All right. Yeah, there. I got to tell you, the Sea of Galilee was so peaceful and so beautiful. And again, it was one of the 2 days that we actually had sunshine. And so it was just amazing to behold how amazing and the history, what took place on this piece of water and the sun and the clouds and the rays just kind of inspired me tremendously. So next slide. So part of my new journey was to be baptized at Jordan. And so I had a new family, and this was part of the family from Illuminate that I was baptized with. And so you can see us all standing here, and Pastor Steve's in the back behind me. And when it was my turn to get baptized, go back. Yeah, we're good after that. Yeah, there we go. When it was my turn to get baptized, God came to me, and he said, this is where you're going. This is who you are. And I said to him, I said, you know, my Lord and Savior and my new family members from Illuminate, please continue to share with me your grace and your guidance on this new journey, along with the courage and the fortitude to carry out the Lord's will for me. And it was crazy because getting in that water was like stepping into a freezer. It was so once I was baptized, I really felt warm. I didn't notice the cold as much. And, you know, once we were all baptized, we got out and Travis and Amanda sang a hymn and we all joined in, and it was just a beautiful moment. Well, out of nowhere, this woman comes over and she's like, I need somebody to baptize me. I just need somebody. And it didn't appear that she was with a group. And so, interesting enough, Pastor Steve recognized her language because she was Spanish and she was from Argentina. So he started speaking Spanish to her. So it was like, again, another God moment. And we were just in amazement. And so Pastor Steve baptized her in her language. And she was just so grateful after it was all done. It was just an amazing, it was a beautiful experience because not only was I baptized along with my family members, but I also got to see someone else, a stranger, who's in the same situation that we all are in following the Lord. See, I knew more than I thought I did. A few days later, we traveled to see St. Anne's Church in Jerusalem. And this church marks the traditional site of Jesus' maternal grandparents. And they believe that it's the birthplace of the Virgin Mary or somewhere in the vicinity. We kept hearing that throughout the whole thing. Somewhere in the vicinity. It might be over there, but we think it's over here, but it could be over there. But we're in the vicinity. And so this was a place where they imagined that the Virgin Mary grew up with her parents. The church was also remarkably well known for its acoustics and its reverberating echoes. And so while we were there, again, Amanda and Travis, who have amazing voices, sang a hymn. And it was just an amazing experience listening in church to hear these reverberating sounds and the acoustics. And it was just so touching. After they were finished, and we were kind of hanging out, praying, and just taking in the sights, and suddenly there was another group of people that were standing in front by the altar, and they began singing, only they sang in Spanish. So we weren't sure if they were the same group as Andrea from Argentina, but again, they were speaking in Spanish, singing. And then as I looked around the room, there were people from Asia. I couldn't tell if it was Korean or Chinese or Japanese. I couldn't tell. But the thing that struck me at that moment in time was that, my presence and my new journey is not just here with Illuminate. Excuse me for getting emotional. But it's really with people from all over the world. And that was the thing I noticed more than, a lot of the things, because it was just so overwhelming. The knowledge, the places, the people, everything, the information was so overwhelming, but I always felt at peace. And then I realized that these were people from all over the world, that we all share the same wants and needs, and that's to show and to walk the Lord, walk the path that the Lord has for us. And so that kind of was the beginning of my journey, and there was just really too much to talk about, but this I felt like was the most important. So thank you so much, Illuminate. You're my new family now, and I'm looking forward to getting to meet you all.
Thanks, Kathy. Yeah, I think I'm going to have to try and wing it. I'm glad I practiced this a couple times because I don't think I can handle all these instruments.
Do you want me to hit the clicker?
Ooh, yeah, I just don't know where the pictures are. That's a problem now that we're not in order. But I wanted to find, if you can go backwards, I think I was going to talk first about, well, I have the picture of Fred and Pierre at Caesarea. Go the other way.
Maybe I shouldn't be doing
go
this.
Go the other way.
Oh. This way?
Yeah.
Well, maybe we should
Okay, we'll just go ahead and talk. If you can find some pictures, go ahead. But anyway, so, well, and one of the things that Kathy mentioned was the overwhelmingness. I was lucky enough to go on the trip in 2019, and I did get baptized in the Jordan River at that point in time. And unfortunately, just like Jason was talking about this past Sunday, I was so more concerned about what I was going to say and was my gown going to come up when I went in the water and those kinds of things that I didn't really focus on what was happening as I was being baptized in the Jordan River. And this time, being able to watch and being able to listen and really be present in the moment was just such a beautiful thing. And it was just such a nice thing to share. Amanda, I know you were in charge of the videoing of everything, but I mean, even going back and watching it on the videos, I get chills. We did go, I had a great picture in there of Caesarea. It was our guide, Pierre, and our leader, Fred. Try it. In Caesarea, because Herod was known all over, you know, Israel, obviously, for being a great builder, a great engineer, and Caesarea is one of those places that he put a palace right on the edge of the Mediterranean. Great summer home. This is it. Well, where they're sitting is an entry to the...
Sorry, I just remember what that is.
The entry to a little horse race rink that he built. Everybody has to have one next to their home, right? Yeah. And this, where they are sitting, was actually the public restrooms because they have, they're sitting where people, when they'd come in or need to go to the bathroom while they're in watching, would come and relieve themselves. And there's a whole engineered tunnel system underneath of that where it takes the waste away and gets rid of it. And it was like, okay. So Pierre is our guide from Israel, from Haifa is where he lives. On the right, and Fred was our leader. A lot of you may know him. He attends Illuminate and has been around since the beginning, I think. So Pierre was, it was fascinating to talk to him because he's got such a background in schooling and theology and such a love of Christ and everything that he, everywhere we were with him, he just had a passion about sharing what he knows about the place where Jesus walked. And one of the places we went that you might have heard of is called Masada. I've got that little, the model that's up at the top of Masada. But Masada is one of the places that Herod built. It's down at the south end of the Dead Sea. And he, it just what a palace. It's on the top of a mesa, so it's fairly flat, but you can see it steps down like that. And he had the palace and the bathrooms and all these. It took him over 10 years to build. And that, I guess, was his winter home. So some of the crowd was eager enough to climb down to the ruins at the bottom side. So some of us stayed up top with Pierre. And Pierre was sharing with us a dissertation that he had been asked to write, a little article for a Christian publication over in Israel. And he was just so passionate as he was telling us about the subject that they had given him was Herod, the king of the Jews, versus Jesus, the king of the Jews. And it was, I felt a little overwhelmed, and it was a big aha moment for me because I never really thought about Herod as Jewish in all my life. I just, you know, hearing Bible stories, it was like, I thought he was a Roman. And never even dawned on me until Pierre said that, for one thing, so I'm not real proud of that. But the fact that Jesus and Joseph and Mary fled to Egypt. Well, no wonder Herod kicked him out, you know, wanted to kill all the babies. No wonder he didn't have any qualms about beheading John the Baptist and was so fixed on the crucifixion. I mean, it's like Herod wanted to be the eternal king of the Jews. And there was, you know, I could tell the passion that Pierre had in speaking this, and he had it written up and shared it with us. And I did want to read one paragraph because it's just such a beautiful commemoration to what Jesus is to people around the world. Herod built numerous buildings, monuments, and cities. He is well known as the most prolific builder in the Holy Land. Today, what we see from Herod's time are stones and ruins that testify to his greatness as a builder, but those are dead stones. Jesus, 2,000 years ago, had built his church from living stones, and these stones are still alive to testify to his resurrection and spread the word about his love to all people. I mean, it's just, it was at that moment, I mean, I was moved to tears because just the day before, I believe, we had been up in the corner by the Golan Heights where Jesus told Peter, I will build my church on you. You are the rock that I will build this church on. And that's when they do know the general area. And it was like, wow, you know, the living stones. We are the living stones of Jesus here today. And people are, so are all Christians around the world. So that was a real poignant moment for me. And the other one was this last Sunday we were there, we got an opportunity to go to the Alliance Church in Old Jerusalem in the Old City. It's an Arab Christian congregation. And we were, I don't know if we were invited, we kind of crashed their worship service. But it was so moving to me, and it was so, that morning before we left, I was in the hotel room finishing up my Abide study and trying to figure out which attribute of God that I wanted to pick for week five, and worthy just kept coming to my head and heart. And as we went through this, as we participated in the church service, it was great. They had a lot of great music, just like we do here, and but they had, it was in Arabic on the screen, and then they had little English subtitles so we could sing along. So that was kind of cool, but a few songs into it, Worthy is the Lamb came up, and I was like, here I am in tears again, because I'm like, God, how do you do this? I've been thinking Worthy all morning, and here's Worthy of the Lamb. I'm sitting in an Arabic church halfway around the world, people, we don't speak the same language, we didn't grow up the same way, but here our common language is Jesus Christ, and we are here sharing, and it was just such an amazing moment. And then they called for a moment of prayer for all of us and to pray for the person next to you, and this lady immediately reached out and put her hand around my shoulders and her arm and prayed for me. And I'm like, wow, you know, how cool is this, that this woman who doesn't know me, who's Arabic, who, you know, grew up Muslim, is here praying for my safety and my peace and my journey with God. And it was just, again, moved to tears. I found out later, her name was Adele, and she, Fred Beasley, who I showed you earlier, and his wife Kristen have a ministry that they do in the Middle East, and she has been very instrumental in bringing a lot of Muslim women to Christianity. And this was one of them that she had worked with a few years back. So that was a really cool connection that we had too. So,
well, because of time, Amanda,
oh, no.
I know we want to hear from you too. This is, there's so much here. You can tell that there's just so much to glean from their trip. But Amanda, I know if you could just highlight for us,
I'm gonna grab my phone.
What God showed you,
yep,
we would love that.
Okay, you got it. By the way, guys,
yeah.
I thought I was getting here early because for whatever reason I forgot we had to be here at 9, and I thought, oh, I'm gonna be there early. We're gonna have time to rehearse. It's gonna be great. And no, God is trying to break me of my perfectionism. I know that. So, all right. Well, let's see what's most important here. Well, I was really struck by
your microphone.
All right. I was also really struck by the people. As usual, God turned my plans on its head because I assumed that the coolest part for me was going to be to walk where Jesus walked, to see all of the sites where Jesus was. And I found myself seeing the sites, and absolutely, they were super cool, but it was like, this was special because Jesus was once here. And he's not here now. He's in our hearts. He's with us all around everywhere. He's back in the States. I didn't have to come here to be with Jesus. You know, there were some people there that you could tell that the site itself was so important to them. And, you know, yeah, it just was great for me that I realized that we all have him everywhere. And God did protect us. There were several incidents. I won't go through each one, but there were incidents that happened like the day before we got somewhere and then the day after we left somewhere and all these things. And I don't know if I found that a lot of people don't know about the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. The reason that they're warring is because Muslims believe that Abraham's son Ishmael was the one that was the, you know, the father of nations. And Jews believe that it's Isaac, as we believe as Christians, that he was the father of nations. And so they each feel like they're the chosen people, and they're fighting over space that they believe belongs to them, and they're fighting over just that truth. And so that's where all the conflict came from. There, you know, there was a few times where Palestinian people came and attacked Israeli people while we were there in different areas that we were, but God was moving us around. My kids were also nervous about me going, but as you guys said, I felt safe. We saw nothing scary. You know, God protected us the whole time. And it was like we would find out about something later and be like, oh my gosh, wow. But yeah, he protected us. And, you know, it made me think even about the people that were committing these acts. Even they need Jesus. And just like Saul, who was persecuting Christians and killing Christians, when Jesus came to him and turned him into Paul and he wrote a lot of the New Testament, they all need Jesus over there. You know, we need him here and they need him there. We all need him. And
you had mentioned to me, Amanda, how it impressed you what the people there were willing to risk to tell people about Jesus.
Thank you, Marcia. Yeah, so there was, we visited a couple of places. There's photos of them. I don't know if they're in order, but Bethlehem Bible College is a place where people can come and learn the Bible. Kids can come and I'm talking like Muslim kids who come from Muslim families who have Muslim mom and dads can come and learn about Jesus. Anyone can come. They actually have an online program too. There's also the Connect Cafe, which is ran by JEO Ministries, which is Jerusalem Evangelical Outreach Ministries. And they they have this place called the Connect Cafe. I have photos of it too. Yeah, there's a few different ones. And Rami is their director. We have a photo with him too. But it's basically advertised locally as just a coffee place for kids in the neighborhood. But it's actually a ministry where kids are learning about Jesus and they can fellowship with one another. And they're having to go home to their homes and hide their Bibles in their rooms, because if their family discovers that they even own a Bible, they could be killed. There is a Christian community in the Middle East. It's very, very secretive. And so what the ministry is doing is it's giving these people, number one, it's giving these people a place to go to fellowship with one another, but it's also, people are making disciples there. People are going into their Muslim communities where they're risking their lives, and they're making disciples of Christ there. And it reminded me of back in Jesus's day, after Jesus went back to heaven, the disciples went out and were making disciples, and it was just as dangerous for them back then. And they were out risking their lives, and in fact, all of them except John were martyred. They were killed for the faith. And these people are putting their lives on the line doing the same thing right now. And these organizations are, you know, they need our help too. We're here and we have all the comforts and freedoms of being able to worship how and when and that we want to, and it's easy for us to get comfortable in that and not really think about the rest of the world and kind of go, well, they're different, or maybe, you know, but we all have the same God. We all have the same Jesus, and he wants us to use what we were given, the freedoms we were given, and help those people, you know, that we weren't given these just for our own comforts, you know. And so I just wanted to leave you with a scripture. I wanted to leave you with the word of God. I wanted to challenge all of us, including myself, to ask yourselves, what is it that God wants me to do? What role do I play in that? Because, you know, God can do all things, and he allows us to be part of his kingdom, and he allows us to do his work and be part of that. So I'm going to leave you with a scripture. It is 1 John 3:17. It is from the study that we've been doing. I had it pulled up. Give me one second. So 1 John 3:17, and it says, But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? And it's not to, you know, talk down to us or make us feel like we're wrong or evil, but I will challenge us all to not leave here today and go back to our comfortable lives and forget about it, but to let it stay on your hearts, pray about it, ask God what our role is in it. And I have those websites. I don't have them up on the screen. We don't have them up on the screen, but I have the websites if you're interested in giving financially. You can email the director. They need people to do different things and even to bring awareness. And so that's what I'm trying to do today, is just bring awareness to it. And again, if you would like to help in any way, let any of us know. We can put you in contact with the right people. And that's about it.
Thank you, ladies. I'm sure that they would love to talk to any of you. You could come see them anytime and ask them a question or just get more information. But we just want to thank you for your testimony. Let me just pray before we go here. Father God, I'm just so thankful for testimonies. Lord, you show us who you are through others. You show us who you are through your word. And we're thankful for that, Lord. You are our God. You are the one true God. And you are the true God everywhere, in every part of the world. So we thank you, Lord, for this testimony, and we ask that you go with us today in our studies, and you reveal yourself to us, Lord, in a deeper way. In Jesus' name, amen.